What's going on, everybody? It's your boy, Nicey Chunga Benny. I'm here with my co-host, Greg King.
What's good, everybody?
And you're listening to the Ball Fake Podcast. Welcome back to another episode. It's now episode 24. If you're new to the channel, make sure to like and subscribe. Turn on post notifications. Say something to us in the comment section. And if you're listening on Apple Podcasts or Spotify, make sure to give us a nice little review. But before we start today's video, I just want to give a quick shout out to our subscriber of the day. Shout out our boy, Skylar Wood. We appreciate you liking and subscribing, turning on post notifications, and just watching every single video. But as for today's video, we're going to talk about Lonzo Ball being thrown in a whole bunch of trade rumors. And just to start off with, we all know Lonzo, he obviously hasn't had the best season. You know, he's currently averaging 12-4-4. It's pretty similar to his little brother's stat line, which is bad because, you know, Lonzo, he averages around like 32 minutes a game, and he's starting in the NBA. So with that being said, Lonzo, he hasn't really shown much promise, you know, not only in this season, but just throughout his entire career. You know, this is his fourth season in the NBA. He hasn't really showcased his ability to his abilities and his talents this year, just because, you know, the way that they've been playing him, they haven't really given him the keys to the offense. And on top of that, he's been very injury prone. He's actually been injured in every single season that he's played in the NBA, which is a bit of a concern, especially with him being in his contract year. So he's gonna have to definitely perform well this year, which he hasn't done so far. But like I said, I mean, they've been putting him in the wrong spots. They've been utilizing him in the wrong way. With that being said, you know, they've kind of been treating him like he's a 3-and-D type of guy, you know what I'm saying, just placing him in the corner while Brandon Ingram and, you know what I'm saying, Zion Williams kind of run the show. But his inconsistencies as well, it's also been something that, you know, has been a huge concern, because, you know, one night Lonzo, he can give you 16-6-6, and then the next night he'll go out and give you 6-4-5, you know, a triple single. So I mean, like, these are things that, you know, we don't like to see, especially coming from a number two pick. And I honestly kind of hate how some people are starting to call him a bust, because I don't really feel like Lonzo is a bust whatsoever. I feel In order for you to be a bust, I feel like you have to, you know what I'm saying, not only do you have to, like, not reach expectation, but I feel like you have to have no more, like, potential. And I feel like Lonzo has a lot of potential just left, because we've seen him have good outstanding games, you know, and he's just been very inconsistent. And, you know, he kind of goes out and lays an egg every other game. So it's like,
He just need to get that confidence back. I think that plays in a part of what the Pelicans are trying to do with him, Stan Van Gundy. And what I've been saying in previous videos, like, I really don't like that hire, because what he said, he wants to make him a 3-and-D player, like you said, and wants to make him a spot-up shooter, and that's not what he is. He needs to go back to playmaking and doing what he really does and what he likes to do, getting out in transition, finding open shots for teammates, putting everybody else in a good position, but also finding stuff for himself. And I think finding open opportunities for himself, and that's another reason why he's struggling. His percentage is 38% for the field goal, 28% from the three-point line. Like, he's not really getting to his spots, and like you've been saying, like, he hasn't really finding his niche in the offense. And he's like I've been saying, like, he's kind of hesitant, like, with shots and, like, getting to the rim, and I don't know what's really going on with him. I don't know why he's not comfortable, but he just doesn't look like the old Lonzo, doesn't look like himself. And I think if he had more confidence in himself, and the organization had more confidence in himself, he would be flourishing right now and would be making plays and would be having fun out there, and he's just not looking like it.
Well, I think the reason why, you know, the organization doesn't have much confidence in him is because he doesn't have much confidence
in himself.
And with that being said, I mean, he obviously he lacks a lot of skill in a half court set, which is why, you know, he'd rather play in transition. But you can't play in transition. The entire game.
Yeah.
You know, you're going to have to be able to make plays in a half court set, not only make plays for other people, but for yourself as well. You know, he needs to do a better job. I would like to really see Lonzo Ball work on coming off the pick and rolls and pulling up for a 15 footer on a consistent basis, and, you know, adding more moves, because Lonzo, he really can't dribble. And if you're not, you know what I'm saying, good dribbling the basketball, it kind of affects your shot slightly, which could lead to, you know what I'm saying, lower percentages than normal. So if he can be able to fix all those, you know what I'm saying, issues, I think Lonzo, he's definitely got a bright future. And like I said, he's showcased that he can play in this league. He's had big games, and he, for someone who actually struggles shooting the basketball, he's come up clutch a fuck ton, you know what I'm saying, in big games, you know. But the media is not going to talk about that. But I mean, his struggles have obviously led to these trade talks and everything. And one team that I feel like definitely should trade for him and is the best fit is the Los Angeles Clippers. You know, For one, I mean, he'd be the primary ball handler there. You know, he's got two dominant three-level scorers he can rely on. That way he doesn't have to, you know what I'm saying, showcase his ability to score the ball, which he can, but, you know, he definitely has his, you know what I'm saying, flaws in his game. But he also would help them defensively. You know, Lonzo Ball, he's probably a top five point guard on the defensive end of the basketball in the NBA, which is something that a lot of people may not know. But on top of that, you know, he would help their offensive efficiency, because it seems like the Clippers, they have everything going well for them. They've got scores. They've got two primary scores. They got a decent amount of shooting around them, and they've got a pretty good front court, but they don't have any playmakers. Patrick Beverley is not a playmaker, and I think implementing Lonzo Ball into that offense would definitely help with their efficiency and their overall game. But what's your opinion on Lonzo to LA?
I love it, just because it would help out Paul George. I think it would take the pressure off of Paul George. I think he could get Paul George in the right spots. I don't think Paul George would have to do a lot. I think he would offset and kind of sometimes get transition baskets for them and actually help them on the defensive end too in the backcourt. Yeah, they might lose Patrick Beverley, but really he's just the heart and soul and just the emotional guy of that team. But bringing in a guy like Lonzo, who can play, make, defend, rebound, and get out in transition, I think it'd be helpful for the Clippers, who definitely on the offensive end need more, you know, offensive presence and playmaking outside of just Paul George and Kawhi Leonard.
Right. And on top of that, Lonzo, he wouldn't be forced to be to play off ball as much. You know, they wouldn't treat him like a spot up shooter. So yeah, I think LA's definitely the spot for Lonzo. But I think the Dallas Mavericks, at first, when I heard that team having interest, I was kind of excited. You know, I thought Alonzo Ball and a Luka Doncic backcourt would be phenomenal, but
sounded great on paper.
Yeah, but I had to sit back and really think, okay, these are two guys who don't shoot the three ball well. On top of that, Luka Doncic is very ball dominant, and he has a pretty high usage rate, which would hurt Lonzo, because Lonzo needs the ball in his hand, so that wouldn't work out. And then on top of that, with Luka being so ball dominant, there's going to be a lot of – he makes every decision offensively for Dallas, literally. I mean, the guy comes off pick and rolls, whether he's going to, you know what I'm saying, shoot a 15-footer, a long floater, or get his bigs involved. You know, he's going to be the one making all the decisions, which is going to force Lonzo to be what? A spot up
shooter.
So I don't think that's the recipe for success. And on top of that, you know, Lonzo, their offensive efficiency would drop severely. Maybe not severely, but it would definitely take a hit, just because these are two guys who cannot. I mean, Lonzo can't spread the floor for everyone. He's not going to open up the floor for everyone, because, you know, he's shooting 33% from three this year. And like I said, Luka's biggest knock in his game is his 3-point percentile. He's going to make the three ball whenever the game's on the line, which he showcased in the postseason this past season. But I mean, on a regular basis,
it's not happening. And with Lonzo not being aggressive and not putting pressure on the defense, it's not going to work.
Right, especially since he struggles in the half court set. But I think the next best team for Lonzo to, you know what I'm saying, appear on is the New York Knicks, man. I really think this would be a good spot, you know, just because, you know, it's kind of hit or miss. I mean, it's got its positives and its negatives, you know. I mean, one negative I'd say is, I mean, the Knicks, they have three ISO players: Elfrid Payton, RJ Barrett, Julius Randle. Despite that, though, they do look pretty promising. You know, Tom Thibodeau, he's done a good job utilizing everyone. You know, they kind of playing through Julius Randle a lot. You know, he's basically their playmaker. He makes plays for not only himself, but his teammates as well. They, you know, they play in a high post a lot through him. And, you know, he's been having a, you know what I'm saying, career best year. You know, all of his numbers have improved as far as I'm concerned. And, you know, Tom Thibodeau, he's really implementing an offense that, you know, has flourished so far for the Knicks. But one thing that they definitely need is three-point shooting and a point guard. Yeah. Lonzo Ball, he can help with the point guard position. You know, I think they would allow him to, you know what I'm saying, have the keys to the offense. My only thing is, will RJ Barrett and, you know, guys like Julius Randle defer to Lonzo and allow him to really run the show, you know? Because, like I said, RJ Barrett, I don't know who the hell RJ Barrett thinks he is. I mean, he's a great player, but, bro, you're not Kevin Durant. You know what I mean? So you don't need all those isolation plays and things of that nature. And Julius Randle, I have to applaud him just because, you know, early in his career, he tried to do too much, things that he didn't have in his bag. And, you know what I'm saying? Stuff like that, man. Like, and he was a really bad decision maker and somebody who didn't understand time and score. And, you know what I'm saying? Just stuff like that. So I have to
His feel of the game on the court. Yeah.
Yeah. I've definitely got to applaud Julius Randle for that. But I mean,
I think if they add Lonzo, I think with a guy like Mitchell Robinson and Julius Randle, I think they can get out in transition with both of those guys. Kind of like when Lonzo's on the court and he actually plays aggressive, he does with Zion. And I think he can do that with the Knicks.
Right. And really showcase their athleticism. But the next spot is the Orlando Magic. This is the worst spot.
I don't like it.
It's the worst spot. You know, adding Lonzo, it would hurt Cole Anthony's development extremely. I mean, you know, Cole Anthony, not very ball dominant, but he's somebody who needs the ball in his hands in order to be productive. And with that being said, once again, that's gonna make Lonzo have to play off ball more, which is not his strengths whatsoever. But on top of that, I think Markelle Fultz, he fits way better with Cole Anthony as opposed to Lonzo Ball, just because, you know, they kind of offset each other's game. Whatever Cole Anthony can't do, Markelle Fultz can, and you know what I'm saying, it's the other way around. But yeah, I mean, what are your opinions on this possible landing spot?
Yeah, and if they added Lonzo to that, like, the pick and roll just wouldn't be right. Like, when I watched the Magic before Markelle Fultz got hurt, the pressure that he put on the defense with him and Vucevic off the pick and pop, it's just incredible. And like the spread the floor, Terrence Ross on the wing and stuff like that, like, they opened up the floor a lot. And with Lonzo on the pick and roll with Vucevic, I just don't see how that would really work. And with Lonzo not being aggressive all the time, I just don't see it working, and it would just really hurt the Orlando's chemistry and offense.
Right. I don't even want to spend too much time on the Magic, but as far as the next spot, the Toronto Raptors, I think this is a decent spot for Lonzo. You know, I mean, for one, they're trying to get rid of Kyle Lowry. You know, Kyle Lowry, he hasn't been too happy in Toronto as of late. You know, they've been struggling throughout this entire season. He kind of gets into his little arguments with Nick Nurse, you know, at times. I'm not sure if it's toxic enough to, you know what I'm saying, where the point where that's the reason why he wants to leave. But, I mean, Kyle Lowry, he wants to be on a contending team. And so far in the season, the Toronto Raptors, they're not looking too promising from that standpoint. So I think putting Lonzo in replacement to Lowry, I think it would be, you know, it would be a decent replacement, just because, you know, I mean, on the defensive end, you don't lose much. You actually kind of gain more. Yeah. Lonzo, he's got active hands. He doesn't take as many charges as Kyle Lowry does, but
he's got a hustle like Kyle Lowry on defense.
Right, and his defense is going to translate to the offensive end, because they're going to definitely get out and run, and guys like Boucher will be able to, you know what I'm saying, showcase their athleticism, and he'll be able to, you know what I'm saying, find the open shooters in transition, like, you know, Norman Powell, just guys like that, Fred VanVleet as well. But I mean, what's your thoughts on the Toronto Raptors landing spot?
Yeah, I would like that. I think he'd be able to play make and stuff like that. But I think it really just goes back to, with the Raptors, it really just goes back with Pascal Siakam struggling right now. I think with adding Lonzo, I think it would take the pressure off of him and get back to, you know, the Pascal Siakam that we know, and get him in the right spots that Lonzo will help with his playmaking ability on the offensive end. So I think it would be a great fit.
Right. I also feel like Lonzo would kind of, you know what I'm saying, help Siakam get to his spots better. And yeah, you know what I'm saying? I feel like, you know, Lonzo, he doesn't have a low IQ. He's a smart basketball player. It's just, you know what I'm saying, the confidence thing. Once again, I mean, putting pressure on the defense.
Confidence and aggressiveness. That's two things that he needs to figure out.
Yeah, but yeah, I feel like he'll quickly learn Siakam's spots on the floor and where he's most effective at. And also, I think it'll allow Boucher to really showcase his athleticism. I mean, I could see the half-court lobs in transition right now. I mean, I think it would be a beautiful sight to, you know, put Lonzo in that position in Toronto. And on top of that, they're going to give him the keys to the offense, because obviously Lowry's gone. And then you also stay pretty young. You know, they don't have the an old nucleus, really. I mean, I think, Siakam's probably like 26, 28 years old. Yeah. Stanley Johnson's probably like 25. So they got a pretty decent core that's, you know what I'm saying, not aging too old. And OG Anunoby, he's also going to be able to contribute to, you know what I'm saying, this lineup as well. Because Toronto, they've got a lot of pieces. You know, they won a championship 2 years ago. We can't forget about that. But yeah, I feel like adding Lonzo into Toronto's lineup and everything, it would allow them to, you know what I'm saying, really showcase that they have a number of options that can be productive on a nightly basis, but they just haven't been playing well as a unit. And I think putting Lonzo in that situation will allow everyone to play at a better rate. But I think that's all that we have for you guys today. Make sure you guys like and subscribe, turn on post notifications. If you're listening on Apple Podcasts and Spotify, make sure to give us a nice little review. We'd appreciate that. Once again, shout out to our subscriber today, Skylar Wood. We appreciate you watching all our videos and listening to every single episode. But outside of that, it's your boy, Nicely Chunga Benny. I'm here with my co-host, Greg King. And we out.
We out.